Grace and peace be with you, and also with you. Once again, as the season of Lent begins, we are summoned by a gracious and merciful God. We respond to God's steadfast love, calling us together in praise. Let us bow before the one who creates. We approach God in reverence and wonder, rejoicing in God's grace. Walk humbly before God in prayer and fasting and giving. We seek the one who upholds each of us with a willing spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, we are constantly bombarded with many temptations throughout the day. When we give in to those temptations, where do we turn? Always to you with your never-ending grace. You teach, counsel, and guide us on how we should go. We rejoice in your unfailing love. Amen.
Good morning. So as we start Lent, the first Sunday in Lent today, we'll start with the Lenten hymn that's in our hymn books. And you'll find that on number 269, Lord, who throughout these 40 days, we will sing verses or stanzas 1, 2, and 4. So jump over 3, please. Would you please stand and join with me in singing, Lord, who throughout these 40 days?
So we read in the Gospels that where two or three are gathered in God's name, that God is present. So you being here today and joining us online and through our televised broadcast, you bring alive the presence of the risen Christ. And we thank you for your presence. And to celebrate that you're here today, we have what we call our Hey Card, and we invite everyone gathered to take the time to fill this out. You may have a special prayer concern. If you're new here, welcome. You may want to give us your contact info so that I can get to know you in the coming days in a more meaningful way. Some of you may prefer to connect with us in a digital way, and we have a QR code on the back of the pew and in our bulletin. And if you're worshiping online, you can go to our website and connect with us in that way. As we do every single week, we take up an offering. And this is another way to praise God, giving thanks to God for all that God has given us. And so as we take up our offering today, we want to thank you for praising God, and we thank you for your generosity. And there are many ways to give. You don't just have to give in the offering plate. So if you forgot your cash or your checkbook, no big deal. You can still give to our church, and the ways you can do so are seen there or located on the screen. Will you pray with me? Oh God, so many times we focus on where we are lacking, and help us to remember how blessed we are and use these gifts that we generously share today. And may they bring honor and glory to your name and kingdom. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Please remain standing as we affirm our faith by reciting or reading the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
I'm just a poor wayfaring stranger, a traveling through this world of woe. But there's no sickness, toil, nor danger in that bright land to which I go. I'm going there to see my Father. I'm going there no more to roam. I'm just a going over Jordan. I'm just a fear no more. Mother's there, expect in me. Father's waiting too. Lots of folk gathered there. All the friends I knew, I'm going there to see my Savior. I'm going there, no more to roam. I'm just a going over Jordan. I'm just a going over home. I'm just a
The Lord be with you and also with you. Will you pray with me? Loving and gracious Lord, as we begin this Lenten season, we give you thanks for this time, this special time, to reflect on the way to the cross. It's not an easy way as we know it, but it's the right way to follow your Son, Jesus. And we ask for your forgiveness when we stray from that pathway. Bring us closer to those who need us the most. May this season allow us to tear down those walls around ourselves so that we may become your hands and your feet. Not just to some, but to all. And we pray for those who are ill in body or in spirit. For those who feel they have nowhere to go and no one to turn to and no one they can trust. And we pray for those without good food or shelter. Give comfort to all who are grieving. And most of all, hear the prayers that are on each and every one of our hearts, those we are so scared to say out loud, and those that only you know. Today's world, goodness, what a mess. I pray for the people of Turkey. Pray for the people of Ukraine. Just passing this first anniversary of this war, this horrible war. We ask for you to help bring peace and justice for war, whether it is in our homes, our community, or throughout the world. We ask you to lift up our young people, and may we be the examples for all these young people to follow. For they are our future. Minister by your Spirit and by us for whom we have prayed, and help us to walk faithfully in the path of our Lord Jesus Christ. And now let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, church. If you're able, please stand and let's join together in the next song. Word of God, speak.
I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak, would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know your end is plain. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet, hear your voice. Word of God, speak, would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. Be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your loneliness. Word of God, speak, would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty. I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay.
Thank you. You may be seated.
The scripture for today is Matthew 4, verses 1 through 17. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you're the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you're the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give to you if you'll fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali, on the road by the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen the light, and for those who sat in the region and shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Cheryl Miller, for reading our gospel passage today, the story of the temptations of Jesus from Matthew's gospel. Today is the first Sunday in the Lenten season, and on this day, the church invites us to read some variation of the story of Jesus in the wilderness being tempted by the devil. So we read it from Matthew's gospel this Sunday. And Lent is really about getting back to the basics. We focus on repenting, repentance. And I don't mean that in a shame-filled kind of way or a punitive kind of way. I mean it in the most life-giving sense possible. Repent means to turn back or to return or to turn towards again and again and again to God or towards God. If you were here for the Ash Wednesday service, you heard me talk about the three pillars of Lent that Jesus talks about in his Sermon on the Mount. And these are practices to help us turn back to God. And I want to touch on these three just in case you weren't able to make it. The first practice, a pillar of Lent that Jesus talks about, is the giving of alms. And that's more than generosity. That's more than giving to your favorite charity or to your favorite church, which we hope you will do all Lent, summer, and year long. But when Jesus speaks of giving alms, he specifically means giving to the poor. Because we tend to push the poor to the margins. And Jesus, when he says the last shall be first and the first shall be last, he's talking about the poor, those cast aside. Are brought to the center of the table. Blessed are the poor. Jesus cherishes the poor, and so shall we. So this is one way of repenting and returning back to God. The second way is through prayer. And we talk a lot about prayer, and we want to pray all year long, but during Lent, we're extra intentional. It reminds me of this professor in seminary. She was trying to teach her students the importance of prayer, and she encouraged them to pray 15 minutes every single day. And they were giving her all kinds of reasons why that wasn't happening, and they were resisting. And she finally quoted one of those Geico ads. She said, "Everybody knows 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on your car insurance." And then she said, just 15 minutes of daily prayer could also do you a world of good. And pointing to this very passage that we're about to delve into, she said, what if our greatest temptation is the temptation not to pray at all? And so we pray as we seek to turn back to God, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And the third pillar of Lent is the one we resist most of all. It's really what this whole passage of Scripture is all about. It's fasting. And by that I mean refraining. Refraining from getting what we want because we want it precisely when we want it. Because when we refrain, when we do this, it tends to expose all our personal idols, which then exposes this void inside us all that only God and God alone can fill. So as preparing for this sermon, I'm just reminded how profound this section of Scripture truly is. And I'm also reminded that, you know, I can only joggle or cater to your imaginations. It's up to you and to me to go to that deserted place to sort these things out, to figure out who you are as it relates to God. It's up to you and me in solitude to come to terms to deal with these wild beasts and these angels, and to discern the difference and let the truth emerge. So as we prepare to do that, I want to invite us to take a step back and take a breath, relax our shoulders. Our willingness is everything. So let's invite the Holy Spirit to allow some truth to emerge in our lives. Will you pray with me? Oh God, may the words of my mouth, as well as the meditations and reflections of all our hearts, may they be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Lent is the time for us to consider the heavy weight of trials and tribulations. And whether we like it or not, want it or not, accept it or not, a big part of being human is that at some point or another, we are going to be tested. We are going to face trials and tribulations. Now, we're early on in Matthew's gospel. We're just in the fourth chapter of a 28-chapter long gospel. And Jesus, you may recall, has just been what? Baptized. He's just been baptized by John the Baptizer in the River Jordan. And the Spirit, the same Spirit that alights upon his shoulder, we are told, leads him into the wilderness, echoing the experience of his faith ancestors, Moses and the people of God, we call them the Israelites, and how they wandered in the desert for 40 years, finding their way out of captivity and into, for some of them, the promised land. We have not yet gotten to Jesus' public ministry. Jesus hasn't even started his full-time ministry yet when he's tested by this tempter. You know, by the way, there may be Lent, may be the only time during worship all year long that the devil whispers in our ears. This encounter with the devil and Jesus is super close up. It is so intense, it's so intimate that one has to wonder if the entire conversation transpires inside Jesus' own heart. This wilderness interlude between his baptism and his public ministry is all about identity. The author of Matthew's Gospels wants you and I to know precisely who Jesus is, and whose he is. And we know from his baptism, because we were told from that voice in heaven, meaning God, that God said of Jesus, "This is my son, the beloved, with whom I am well pleased." And before the world is going to know that, because of his ministry in the world, Satan knows it. So Satan wants to know, if you really are the Son of God, then what's that going to look like? Now, that's the NRSV translation that we read today. If you are the Son of God. If you are the Son of God. The translation I prefer comes from a later translation, the Common English Bible, which says, since. Because Jesus doesn't have to prove anything. So Satan says to him, since you are the Son of God, show us what that's going to look like in your ministry, in your service, and in your leadership. Because we already know one. We already know one Son of God and what this Son of God looks like in the world. Recall from your history, the first emperor of the Roman Empire was Caesar Augustus. Like other emperors, he called himself, get this, the same name, Son of God. In fact, engraved on coins at that time, currency of the day, it was common to see the image of the emperor engraved on the coin. And sometimes a Latin phrase like this, Divi Filius, would be engraved. And that phrase means divine son or son of God. So we know what the Roman emperor looks like as the son of God, but what does Jesus look like? And that's the question. That's the question that sets up and surrounds these temptations. And there are three. Title of my sermon, Three Temptations. Most of you are probably very familiar with this conversation between the devil and Jesus. You probably know it by heart, but for those who need, those of us like me who need a refresher every single Lent, here it goes. In the middle of the wilderness, Jesus, we are told, at the very beginning of his time. It's told a little differently in Luke's gospel. All we know from Luke is that he fasted and was in the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights. But here, at the very beginning, we're told, while he's in the wilderness, that he has fasted already for 40 days and 40 nights, which means he is bereft. He's famished. He's empty. Now, I don't know about you, but when I go a while without eating, I can be pretty irritable and hangry, as they say. And I'm not at my best. I'm vulnerable. And the devil knows this. He's got Jesus right where he wants him. He wants to kick him while he's already down. In my own life, I've been kind of down. I've been going through some personal challenges, and I feel like I'm karate chopping, you know, just everything coming at me. And so as I was reflecting on this text, I was thinking about these survival stories in particular that I'm aware of in war-torn times. There's this great book that came out in 2010 called Unbroken. You're probably familiar with it. Laura Helen Brand, wonderful writer. She also wrote Seabiscuit. Both of these books were made into movies. They don't compare to the books. Anyway, Unbroken is based on a true story about a veteran, American veteran from World War II, who is also an Olympic athlete. He was a track star. His name is Louis Zamperini. And this book is about his experience in Japan as a prisoner of war. And when you read about what he went through, it is just unbelievable that he survived. Well, anyway, when his plane went down in the Pacific, he had two airmen with him who all made it. They survived and were able to get out of the aircraft. And they ended up in a small life raft in the middle of the ocean. And once they got their bearings, they quickly realized that their only source of food happened to be some chocolate bars. And so they placed them in the pocket of the raft for their survival at sea. They had to be super fair and conscientious and cautious about how they divided up and rationed the chocolate because they didn't know how long they were going to be wrecked at sea. They went to sleep on that first night. When they woke up the next morning, the chocolate was all gone. You see, during the night, the other two men, while they were sleeping, one of the men gave in and ate every single last piece of that chocolate. Well, now you know what I did not give up for Lent. You see, the thing about succumbing to temptations, 9 times out of 10, it doesn't just affect you. So often it affects so many others. The first temptation that Jesus faces goes like this. Since you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread. Now, I've never been to the Judean wilderness. I know some of you have. I hope to go one day. But I've watched enough YouTube videos that feature this landscape and how rugged and barren and brown and beige it is and all these mountains of layers upon layers of limestone that can easily crumble in all sorts of sizes of rock, which says to me that if Jesus had succumbed to this temptation, he could have had all the bread he could have ever wanted. And that had me thinking about one of our local heroes. Peace be with him. He's joined the church triumphant. He was a longtime pillar and member of this church, Harry Bell. He died at the age of 95, and we buried him not too long ago. He, too, was a World War II veteran, and he was from Hattiesburg. He attended Southern, the University of Southern Mississippi, and shortly after graduating, he was shipped out to sea. He tells me he got very seasick on his way to Europe. He was part of the 106th Infantry, and he fought in that famous battle, the Battle of the Bulge. After 3 days of fighting, his entire outfit, about 2,000 plus people, men, they were all captured by the Germans, and they marched them in the bitter cold for 60 plus days. They stored them literally in a hog pen until a train car was available, which they packed them into like cattle, until they landed in a prison camp in Germany. And Harry would talk to me about these conditions. They were all crammed into these horrific quarters where they had bunks that were three levels high, and the mattresses were made of rotten straw or filled with rotten straw, and the bunks were infested with lice. They had to share one hole as a latrine in these quarters. And everyone was sick, and everyone was malnourished. And it didn't help that they served some kind of ersatz coffee, brown water with some kind of roots. And I don't remember how often they served it, but they would serve a loaf of bread filled with sawdust to make it larger to go further. And they would share it divided among eight men. When they were finally liberated, Harry said he weighed 90 pounds, and he was a tall man. After they were liberated, Harry told me that it wasn't automatic. They had to wait hours and days before they were situated. But he remembers there being food available, some food, and they told them, they advised them, you know, don't just dive in and eat all you want. You need to let your bodies have time to adjust, because they haven't had very much for a long period of time. But he remembers, I swear to you, he told me this story. He remembers another soldier who just couldn't stand it. And this soldier saw an ample supply of sugary donuts. And he dove in, and he ate, and he ate, and he ate, and he ate until he couldn't eat anymore. And you know what Harry told me? Those donuts killed him. Now, can you imagine surviving that horrific prison camp experience? You're finally liberated, and you die over donuts. Friends, temptation is real, and it's powerful, and it comes to us all, and it can come at the most, you know, the sneakiest moment imaginable, right when you think you're safe. And Jesus, who is famished, he is starving for his own survival. He says this, "One does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." The second temptation that Jesus faces goes something like this. I like to remember it this way. Now, it's in a different order in Luke's gospel. But in Matthew, the second temptation, you can always remember it by this. Jump! Oh, the stories I could tell you about the times I didn't think twice or wasn't cautious enough. Someone just dared me to go for it, and I did. I'll tell you one. I was at the University of Mississippi, and we had had an ice storm. Not a snow, but an ice storm. The emergency doctor reminded me over and over and over. And we're at this new subdivision, and we were going to go sledding in these laundry baskets. And we're all gathering up there, and we're so excited. I'll go first. Yeah, go for it, Claire. I hit the bottom, And after that, I had a huge gash in my head and two black eyes to show for it. Just jump. The second temptation, the devil says to Jesus, throw yourself down. You see, Jesus is taken by the devil to the highest point of the Holy of Holies. This is the religious center, the spiritual center, to the pinnacle of the temple. And he says, since you are the Son of God, throw yourself down. For it is written, God will command God's angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Notice here that the devil is quoting the Bible, quoting Scripture. Be careful out there. Just because somebody says, the Bible says this, doesn't necessarily mean we should believe it. We need to be discerning about who says what and why. But what Satan really wants to do here, he wants Jesus, if he's the Son of God, since you are the Son of God, prove yourself. Prove that you have divine specialness, divine favor. Come on, just show us that you're one of God's VIPs. You're better, you know. You're better than all the rest. Once again, Jesus does not fall for it because Jesus knows who he is and whose he is. He knows he's one with God and one with all the rest. He's not better or less than anyone. And he passes the second test. And the third temptation resembles this second one, only this time Jesus takes takes Jesus to a high mountain. This is above the kingdoms and the temples now. He takes him even higher to the pinnacle of a mountain where he shows him all the kingdoms and their magnificence, all the kingdoms and their splendor. And Satan says to Jesus, these I will give you. I'll give you all of these if you will fall down and worship me. And Jesus doesn't flinch this time. Away with you, Satan, he says. As it is written, and now Jesus quotes Scripture, worship the Lord your God and serve God only. And then we are told the devil left him and the angels waited on him. It's been noted that these three temptations have to do with the very three things that many of us, and I'm over here on this side of the room for a reason, many of us were brought up not to talk in public or openly about. These temptations, the first one is about economics, money. The second one is about religion. And the third is really about politics. Turn these stones into bread, the first temptation. Economics is really about what we do with our wealth, our goods, our resources in the face of scarcity and survival. Jump off this temple and let God protect you is really about religion. Which religion, tell me, which religion has a monopoly on God? And think of all the eons we have been fighting over such. Who's right? Who's wrong? Who's most favored by God? Who gets special treatment? And finally, looking out over all those kingdoms and their splendor, this third temptation is about politics. Because in the sight of all that that can belong to us, it's so easy to sell out, to sell our souls, our integrity for a seat at the table, for the carrot, for the opportunity to hang on to some kind of power. And Richard Rohr says of these three temptations that they're really about the misuse of power. Even Jesus, he says, must face these subtle disguises before he begins his public ministry. And this warning is for us as well. He says, none of us can handle power, and we all have some amount of it. We all wield some kind of power, whether you're a parent, grandparent, teacher, coach, employer, boss. Maybe the power that you have is caring for an elderly parent or your domestic animals. But we all wield some kind of power in this world. And Richard Rohr says none of us can handle power faithfully until we've passed all of these three tests. I like what Ruth Barrows, another spiritual writer, says. She says, never be full of yourself. Never be emptied of God. The gospel is always calling us to grow, to stretch ourselves. So all week long, as I've been meditating on these trials and tribulations, I've been thinking about our church. And wouldn't you say we've gone through some tested times? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Yeah, we've gone through some trials and tribulations, but have we passed these tests? Are we ready to serve and lead in ministry as Jesus does, as Jesus' followers, sons and daughters of God? I was thinking about when it comes to the economy, wealth and goods and resources in the face of scarcity, are we more worried about our own church survival or our faith and trust in God? Test number one. Test number two, when it comes to religion, are we more worried about being right or in right relationship? What makes us any more special than any other congregation, denomination, creed, or spiritually unaffiliated group? Are we better than or less than any group of people who decide to take another course of action or direction or hold on to a certain kind of doctrine? What makes us better than or less than? And then when it comes to politics, in this new post-Christian nation that you and I are a part of now, will mainline moderate Methodism ever again have any real political clout, power, and impact? Or is our local and much more humble influence much more in line with the way and example of Jesus, who, by the way, never got outside a 90-mile radius on foot? What's astonishing to me here about this experience of Jesus in the wilderness is that he refrains. He has the entire world at his fingertips. Great things. He has bread, he has scripture, he has kingdoms. And in and of themselves, these were good things. I read this week, we aren't tempted by something unless it is good. But here's the question for us to be asking, church. When is enough enough? What a question to ask this Lenten season. And so, like with Jesus, this wilderness story that's filled with trials and tribulations, it's really about who we are and whose we are as God's beloved sons and daughters. Again, makes me think of Harry Bell. He was around 18 or 19 years old, a prisoner of war. He told me that he had to take the lead when it came to how they would divide up these loaves of bread filled with sawdust so that it would go further. Someone had to take the lead. So he decided among his group that they would do this. They had a wooden knife that someone had found or made, and they took turns cutting the bread, the loaf of bread, into fair, equal pieces, which was actually impossible. And the person that cut the bread, when it was his turn, that person got to eat the crumbs. And this is how they did it, so that they could honor everyone. Harry also says that he prayed often, that he looked forward to this one priest who was Catholic, who would say the Mass regularly. He said, I couldn't wait. He said, I knew I wasn't Catholic, but that did not matter. I clung on every word he had to say. I would never have made it, said Harry. I would never have made it through that ordeal without my faith. It was my faith in God and God alone that got me through it. Lent is about getting back to the basics. Repent, says Jesus, which means to turn and return and keep turning back to God. For the light has dawned in the darkness, and the kingdom of God has come near. And so it begins. On the road by the sea, across the Jordan, in the Galilee region, the ministry of Jesus Christ, crucified and eventually resurrected. And so we wait. But we don't just wait. We anticipate the joy of resurrection. So be it, and so it is. Amen.
If you can, please stand and join us for our closing song.
Plan to sing this song. We're not perfect as a church, but we do seek to center ourselves in loving God and neighbor in the way and example of Jesus Christ, believing that this will lead to our salvation and wholeness. So if you're wanting to be a part of our fellowship or just talk about what God's doing in your life, we would invite you to come forward as we sing this final song.
Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our love. Our love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken, and great are you, Lord. So shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Our mouths, so we pour out our praise to you, oh.
and I can't wait to tell you about it. We have people that are wanting to formally join our church today, and I know we're a little over. I got kind of long-winded. It is Lent. And hey, by the way, Sam Mills, you knocked it out of the park today. Great job. Two of my favorite songs merged together. How about that? It was great. And to all our musicians and our tech support, everyone that helps make our staff of worship happen, let's give them a hand. First, I want to introduce you to Jenny Stevens. So, Jenny, if you'll stand up with me here. And Jenny is no stranger to our church or to me. I've known her a long time. And she's, like I say, many of you are members in my heart way before you become members of our church, and you certainly fall in that category. And she's been on the coast for quite some time and grew up in the Baptist church, has been baptized, very committed, has spent her career primarily in social work, right? Am I right?
Social work in
the schools. And Jenny has kind of dipped her toe in the church here, but when we started Home Under the Dome, she's been all in. And what she said to me is, everybody needs a church home and family. And she said, I didn't fall in love with the preacher. I fell in love with the people of this church.
That's right.
Always remember, the reason people even check out a church has nothing to do with the preacher. It has to do with you offering an invitation. So we're going to receive Jenny into formal fellowship today. And now I want to invite you to meet someone that's pretty new to me, Deanna Theed, T-H-E-A-D. And she's already a United Methodist, and she moved here a year and a half ago and works at a vet clinic in DeIberville?
Wool Market.
Yep. Wool Market, close. And she is from Macon United Methodist Church, which is closer up to where I'm from. Mm-hmm. And her mom is the music director there. And she's thinking about moving down here.
She's considering it.
Okay. So this is your second son? No, you came Ash Wednesday,
yep.
And she came today, and she wants to join, and we're going to receive her. So she's just transferring her membership, and in a way, same for you, Jenny. So what we would ask of you is what we would ask all of us gathered here. And so I'm going to ask this question, and we'll all answer it together. Will you support Christ Church, which is open to everyone? Will you support the United Methodist Church? And will you support First United Methodist Church of Gulfport with these things, your prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness? If so, let's all say we will.
We will.
Great. You can give them a hand to welcome them.
Thank you.
So don't forget, immediately following or once we all kind of get settled and out of here, we'll meet in the substory for anyone that wants to just talk about what's going on in your soul as it relates to Lent and the presence of God. And I'll be there to have that conversation. Will you stand and receive these words of blessing and benediction? Let us all remember that life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who travel the way with us. So be swift to love and make haste to be kind. And may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all.